The views and opinions expressed do not necessarily represent those of Access Fort Wayne, the Allen County Public Library, or any other supporting group. Get involved with Access Fort Wayne and make your own television programming. Call 421-1250 to find out more.
Hello and welcome to the Fort Report. I'm Kevin Leininger, News-Sentinel columnist and reporter. With me today are two men I've known for quite some time, Craig Ladwig and Ron Reinking, both of the Indiana Policy Review Foundation. And Craig is also editor of the monthly magazine.
Right.
So welcome both. We want to talk about primarily today the idea for a convention of the states, which is something you probably have not heard much of yet, but I think you will in the coming months and maybe years. So before we get into that, Craig, maybe very briefly, tell us just a little bit about the Indiana Policy Review Foundation.
Nonprofit education foundation. We were founded in 1989, largely on the purpose is to commission academic research on local issues.
Mm-hmm.
The need was that most academics work on national and international issues because that's where the money is, but there's a lot of good research on Indiana and Fort Wayne. They just need a little incentive to get it out.
Right. And I should mention, I don't think you'd disagree with the characterization that you're primarily a conservative-leaning organization.
No, we don't.
Just
so
right.
We'll get that out so there's no question where we're coming from today.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
Now people have heard of a constitutional convention, which is where the Constitution came from, and this is a little bit different. So, gentlemen, if you could talk a little bit about the idea of a convention of the states, what it is, what it would do, and how it differs from the more familiar constitutional convention.
It's one of the two ways. The constitutional convention is the one way, mm-hmm. and the founders set up the convention of the states as the other way. Kind of interesting that they foresaw that the argument may not be between Democrats and Republicans or this and that, but it may be between the federal government and the states.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the mechanism they put together when we reached a situation where it was the battle was really not partisan,
mm-hmm.
But between federal power, Republican and Democrat, and state power.
And I gather you both think we're at that point where the federal government has pretty much taken over a lot of the powers the Constitution states would be left to the states, which is the whole point of the convention,
yeah.
that you could get together and propose amendments that would rectify that, correct?
Right, that's correct. I think within the past several years, you could see an encroachment of the federal government upon the states, and I think that there are many people among us think that perhaps we've gone over the line on that,
mm-hmm.
and this is, of course, an adjunct that we could perhaps, you know, change the way things are going.
Now, people are more, I think, familiar, people who know anything about the amendment process at all, they're familiar with it normally coming out of Congress than being sent to the states for ratification. This
mm-hmm.
is in Article 5 of the Constitution, never been done though, correct, where the states
correct.
Would gather
right.
to propose amendments that would then go to the states for ratification.
Yeah, and the federal government having nothing to do with
mm-hmm.
it.
Now, the trick is, you need to convene the convention, two-thirds of the states, which is, I think, 34, correct?
Mm-hmm.
And then to actually ratify
38.
Anything coming out would be 38. Have you done the math? Is either one even within the realm of possibility?
Right now, currently, 97% of the states that are needed to call a convention are Republican-controlled.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, the argument to get the, I think that gets you to about 32 states or 33 states even, the argument to get to call a convention is basically, frankly, a Republican argument.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, you have to convince Republicans in these 33 states that
well,
this is a
good not to be
idea.
Too cynical, but I mean, maybe the Democratic states are fairly happy with the way things are going.
We have a tendency to think that's true, right?
And that's another yeah, that's a problem, because if you have all these Republican states as a bloc call a constitutional convention, then you're in a way you're pushing out all these.
Well,
other
and then
states.
You would need 38. Do you get that far?
This count is before there's been a campaign, before there's been any sort of promotion. So it looks real promising, especially when you consider that a constitutional convention, you'd have to deal with 46% Republicans in the Senate and 52% in the House. So we would never get anywhere that way. So. This is, and I think you've talked to Senator Long,
who's State very Senate pro tem from Fort Wayne,
who's very emphatic that this is what's needed to get. And again, this is a state versus federal, not a Republican versus Democrat, although that sets up like that. But I think Senator Long's argument is that the federal government is encroaching so much on state authority that he's turning them into just token.
Well, right, and I should probably mention before we go too much further. You gentlemen are here today because the foundation has written about this issue. We'll be holding a seminar in Fort Wayne later on, which we'll talk about as we move ahead. So this is something you've been involved in promoting. As you mentioned too,
I'd say we're like you, we're studying it. It's an exciting, we deal in discussions, not in
well, it's an idea that there's no flesh on the bones yet, but let's try to build
it. It's an exciting idea.
Right, but it is starting to pick up steam a little bit because there's a national thing I think that's coming up in December that I think is perhaps spearheaded by Senator Long. And so
Mount Vernon,
in Washington. And. So it's not an Indiana concept, but this is something that has attracted the attention of states all over.
Well, let's talk a little bit about where you see the big issues being right now between Washington and the states, and what kinds of amendments might be not only needed, but wise to rectify that.
Well, I think one thing would be perhaps on taxation. Mm-hmm. You could have, I think people have been very much alarmed about what's happened with Obamacare, of course, and the approach that it has to our health. We have a variety of very sensitive issues which would draw fire, whether they could be put through or not, certainly amnesty, but there's a lot of big issues along these lines. Comprehensive immigration reform. And so there's a variety of issues that people are universally concerned about.
Right off the top, a balanced budget I know is very big with the legislators themselves. Term limits would be huge.
I know there's maybe not a direct correlation between Mark Levin's freedom amendments, but I know Dave Long just talked to him the other night, and some of his
proceeds.
Dave endorsed a couple. The 17th Amendment, which took election of senators from the state conventions and gave it to the popular vote. Politically, that might be a hard sell yanking back, but the argument was that was really one way the states maintain some kind of legitimacy within the federal government that they don't have now.
Well, you've got it upside down now, and it's much easier to get reelected as a member of the House because of gerrymandering than it is to become reelected as a senator where you have to deal with the whole state. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of topsy-turvy.
Now, of course, originally the framers put in the 9th and 10th Amendments, which if they had been followed, might have made all this a moot point. You wouldn't need it, but and those reserve the powers not enumerated to the federal government to the states and the people, respectively. Pretty much a dead letter, according to the Supreme Court, though.
Well, I think you raise a really interesting point, not only in the respect that even if we go through with this plan, the idea of enforcement and interpretation presents real issues and difficulties because, you know, we have a constitution right now which some people arguably contend is not being followed. Mm-hmm. So that's another problem.
Only today, as we are recording the show, President Obama bowed to pressure.
Right.
And as far as I can tell, unilaterally,
he's going to allow
health care plans he claims are illegal to be in effect for another year.
That's right.
Now, the bill was passed by Congress. Like it or not, it was legally passed, so far as we can tell, with maybe, you know, shading around the edges. But
right.
And so can the executive really go back in and change a law all by himself?
Well, I'm not so sure that what we're doing here, you know, directly impacts the influence of the executive, and we've certainly gone over the top.
We ought to, and maybe we'll come back to this, Kevin, if you want to. When you line up all the legal difficulties of some of a constitutional convention of the states on the table, it looks daunting, and the enforcement, like he says, but. You know, when you look at it as a political strategist, though, mm-hmm. we've got a horrible debate going on now between that leaves the public out. In other words, an arcanum of budgets, people don't understand nothing, few things more complex than insurance economics. Mm-hmm. But here would we get, if we set in motion, say 10 states pass this convention of the states on, let's take something simple like term limits. Mm-hmm. You get that rolling, people start talking about why do we need term, discussion starts changing, gets a little more constitution-based discussion, then you got 20 states that are in, mm-hmm. you start affecting what goes on in Washington. And this is what happened with the ERA, and I'll sum up with this. The ERA didn't pass, but only because I think most people felt that women's rights were protected by the current Constitution. Mm-hmm. It's hard for me to believe that they would have been worse off if they hadn't pushed for an equal rights amendment.
Well, and I did talk to Senator Long today, and he was very clear about, because, you know, you do this, you open a can of worms that can be good or bad depending on how it happens. So I think Indiana, he is actually talking about legislation that would not only control very tightly the issues that could be debated, but also who would be the delegates, what their charge would be.
Right.
Penalties for not living up to that oath.
Felony
right.
penalty.
So you really right. do need, you don't want to go in with a blank slate because you never know what's going to come out, right?
No.
Right.
No, it's difficult, but I you know, just as somebody that, and I guess that deals with the discussion, I like this discussion a lot better. It's more constructive. You're not having to say that the other side is evil mm-hmm. or lying. You're just saying, let's talk about what would be constitutionally best. Mm-hmm. Now, people who believe things are democracy is working, that we are connected to a constitutional republic, they would be a fool to get involved in the convention of the states or anywhere near it. But if you feel it's disconnected, then you're more inclined to think, well, maybe we ought to have an amendment of some kind and get us reconnected. And that's the test question, I think.
Yeah. Right. Well, you have the technical aspect that if you can move this forward and make it legal is perhaps difficult to do, but perhaps not so much. But even the discussion may promote legislation and change within the way we govern ourselves in the existing legislature.
Well, let me put this to you from a practical standpoint. Even if you achieved your wildest dreams and you got 38 states to put through a series of amendments that you thought would solve all the problems. Theoretically, that could have been done by a minority of the American population. Would that be not only unpopular, but also deemed illegitimate, even though it would have been done within the constitutional framework?
My wildest dream would be a discussion that starts, that changes the moral underpinnings of the nation. So you don't even need a constitutional mm-hmm. convention. And I know that's real wishful thinking. But I think that has to happen at some point. You can't just, it can't be legalese. I think people have to understand why a constitutional convention needs to be called. If they don't understand it, it's a useless exercise.
Well, in some respects, I mean, I'm in favor of the way this is heading, and I really like what's being put on the table. But in some respects, you know, democracy works. I mean, democracy works reasonably well in the respect that the legislature, in some ways, represent those people that put them in office. I mean, legislatures are commonly reelected 90% of the time. And we have a president who was recently reelected for the second time. So the problem is the enforcement and whether we agree with the general populace of our governance, and that depends in large measure. I think that we are crippled by what our founding fathers had, that in order to have a democracy, you have to have an educated and moral people to do that.
And keep in mind, the convention of the states is part of the democratic process. I mean, it has to go back, and people have to vote for it, understand it.
Well, I was going to ask you, and I guess you could look at it either way. Would a convention of the states and resulting amendments represent a triumph of democracy or a failure of democracy in your mind?
That's certainly good questions. In some respects, it might not make any difference because we'll be there in any event, and we'll abide by that amendment.
I think it's a good question, and I think it's if we are at the point where we have to have a convention of the states, and say one of the, or two of the issues and are really divisive, we could imagine some. That's not a good point to be at.
You could argue, and Dave Long said it, you know, the framers put it into the Constitution.
Yep.
They expected it to be used and would probably be shocked that here 200 odd years later it has not been.
Isn't that impressive to me?
They were that
insightful.
Well, I think that it's very interesting that we are sitting here at this time and at this place, and throughout the rest of the states they're also having this conversation, which is an indication that many people know we're on the wrong track here, that we just simply are not doing things right.
Well, let me talk to you about another indication that people think we're on the wrong track, which is the idea of nullification, which some more conservative groups, Tea Partiers and others, are talking about as a more short-term approach to what you're trying to do, which will take years if it happens at all.
Although I've heard 20 states are pretty well lined up. I don't argue your point.
Well, nullification is essentially whereby a legislature or a governor would look at something the federal government is doing, declare it unconstitutional, null and void, and not be bound to it at the state level. The idea being, much as you're talking about, federal government has overstepped its authority. Now, you know, the argument is clearly they've overstepped their authority. This is needed now. We can't wait 2 or 3 years the way things are going to achieve a bigger picture. What do you gentlemen think about that approach? Can you coexist that way?
John C. Calhoun and I were talking about this just the other day.
You didn't look that old.
But I, you know, I'm a classical liberal free market. That'd be a lovely situation. I think that's the way it probably should be. I'm not so sure the Civil War hasn't wiped that out as an option, but
well, we're not quite talking secession, unless you're Colorado.
Well,
but
Senator Long tells me, I defer to the lawyers on this, that has so many legal problems that they'd never get it done. But
well, one of the things that we've not really talked about, and I think that it has to enter the discussion, or certainly is an important part of it, and that is the nuance that we have between the federal government and the states and governance. A thing called money, because the federal government has really dictates the state legislature and the behavior of the states with respect to how they fund the states, and I think that kind of strikes at the core of the way states respond. And if that money supply, if it's restricted or if it's contained in any way, will have a dramatic effect upon the way.
Well, right, they tell you if you want your billions of dollars in highway funding, you must do this.
Sure.
And then again, we get back to if a constitutional convention or a nullification is dangerous, you got to say compared to what?
Compared to
having your state cut off from money because your governor does something that Washington doesn't like.
The good thing about your approach is it's constitutional.
Yeah.
Nullification, I suppose you could argue that it is, but if you're going to take upon yourself the authority to decide what's constitutional, then everybody does that, correct? I mean, the liberal states.
It's a more in-your-face type.
Well, and I think David Long thinks it's a recipe for anarchy, and he might be right.
Right.
I think at least you ought to try your approach first, anyway.
Good point. That's a good point.
So talk a little bit about the event coming up that you will be helping to sponsor on this topic.
A fellow named Rob Nadelson of Colorado Institute, which is a state think tank there, constitutional scholar, has written many books. I think Mark Levin's book depends heavily on his scholarship. We were curious about this. We'd never heard, like most people, we hadn't heard about it. So we asked him if he'd come over, and we were trying to get an April 10th seminar in Fort Wayne where it's a four-hour seminar. He just kind of outlines it. Maybe we'd ask Senator Long to come join us. just get people more at ease or at least conversant in what's involved. I think we've got to start talking about these things. I'm with Ron. I don't see a mere, if we get a new senator or a more conservative senator or a more conservative, that doesn't seem to help. Indiana's been sending pretty good people to Washington for a long time now, and I haven't noticed any.
Right. Well, I don't disagree with that, but I mean, is the Republican Party even constitutional in your mind? I mean, they may be less.
You know, that's one of the things that appeals to me about this. The Republican Party isn't involved.
Right. Well, you know, I talked to Congressman Stutzman, for example, about the farm bill, and you know, we need to get the food stamps out and cut that. And I said, well, you know, are we ever going to get to no farm subsidies? You know, oh well, I'd like to.
I'm working on that.
All the while, and nothing against him. I mean, he's continuing to take the subsidies. So.
And I spent a little time in Washington, as to my shame, but you certainly learn early on that it's very hard to even nail somebody down on a vote. There's so many markup sessions, multiple votes. They've got it. It's very unaccountable process. And for somebody like a well-meaning U.S. representative, it would be a difficult task to make any change in a 20-year career.
Well, Ron, you're a CPA by trade. Do you think the American people are ready for this? I mean, if you tried to balance the budget, I don't know how you get there unless you want to take 200 years without causing so much disruption. You'd have, I mean, literally riots in the street.
Right. Well, you know, perhaps it's just me in my advanced years here, but I don't know as I've ever seen the nation so divided on major, major issues. And we talk in terms of Republican and Democratic parties, but I think that it is really an ideological issue and that is a split. And I'm not certain whether this is just one blip in the long history of the nation or if this is we're at a major turning point within respect to the way that we govern ourselves. And I kind of have a hunch it's the latter.
Well, you think, you know, and Mitt Romney kind of said during the campaign we were at that tipping point where almost half the American people paid no taxes,
right?
So they didn't have a stake in controlling the deficit.
Yeah,
I mean, I think we're about there, right? How do you reverse that?
But the founders anticipated that. They, you know,
well, the Tocqueville did,
all
certainly.
They all talked about it. And this was one of the things that they built into the Constitution to keep that from happening. So, again, that's another strong bit of evidence that maybe the time is right to use that mechanism.
Well, I think legislators have the concept that we can govern ourselves and we can pass laws and direct the way that we live in this world. But there are certain overriding laws that cannot be changed, and that's economic law. And if we can dig a hole and somewhere along the line financially, we're going to have to pay for that. And there is no decision to be made. It's just ultimately going to be there. And I think perhaps we may get very close to that point.
Well, I keep thinking so too. But whoever thought
that's
we,
right.
Whoever thought we could have a $17 trillion debt?
That's right.
Well, stock market at a record high.
I've been saying this for 20 years and been wrong for 20 years.
Yeah, my dad used to always predict a collapse, and I keep thinking one day he'll be right.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, let's talk about a few other issues. You know, the policy review is not a one-trick pony. Mm-hmm. What else is on your plate right now?
Coming up is private property. We're going to dedicate a journal to Indiana is pretty good on its property laws and its eminent domain, but nonetheless, you can't have a situation where a park board decides that a walking trail should go through your backyard and they don't have to listen to the mayor or anyone else. They can just go ahead and do that. We have an array of academics that are going to talk about property is a mysterious to some degree, right? Nobody understands why important it is in creating wealth and attracting investment. It isn't taught in school anymore that property is critical. Mm-hmm. But
Or private.
but it's also an absolute. The Soviets experimented with allowing people to have shops and factories, but at any time the Soviet Union can come close them, so no one would invest. But if you're going to have investment and jobs as a state, you're going to have a consistent, predictable mm-hmm. pr- private property position, and we don't.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm sorry, go ahead, Ron.
Well, I was just going to say an abiding interest of all three of us, I know, is education. And I know the policy review has hit upon that several times.
Well, are you, I haven't seen a whole lot coming out of the review about Common Core, which is the big talk on the
right, because most of our work has been on allowing students to put the money in their backpacks and let the school buildings compete mm-hmm. for those students. But I've been initially really disappointed in Common Core because it's a huge movement. They had a great success, and these two ladies have done a great job. But at the end of it, we say, well, it's not good to have the federal government running your local school system. Mm-hmm. Well, we knew that.
Well,
and
I know
they need to go further.
One other thing you've commented on lately, yes. in reply to Councilman Paddock's. Asked for $200,000 in legacy funds for a study for high-speed rail environmental impact. I take it the foundation is a little skeptical of high-speed in particular and mass transit in general.
Kevin, we can't find anybody that thinks that makes sense, that will defend our numbers. Mm-hmm. And you'd like to not think it's just a boondoggle where, of course, when you get into rail and you get into it's kind of high industrial skills. There's a lot of people interested in it, a lot of unions, a lot of manufacturers, a lot of crony capitalists.
Well, I was going to ask why, if it's mm-hmm. a loser, why do so many people push it? And maybe you just...
Well, that's what makes you suspicious, because the numbers aren't there. It's mm-hmm. And Indiana is one of the last places you want mass transit. I think our car-to-person ratio is just huge here.
Mm-hmm. Right. Any other issues on the horizon that you will be getting involved in that maybe you're not too visible about yet?
Well,
we always like planning and zoning, and mm-hmm. I've always wanted to take, maybe we'll get somebody to do it someday, to go to these cities that have these great master plans, and mm-hmm. you and I as reporters,
smart growth,
mm-hmm. and you and I have sat through many of those meetings as young reporters.
I was just in one today.
And they always paint this vision of the city to be mm-hmm. that we're going to have to make a few sacrifices and discourage a little investment over here and there. And then I like to compare those master plans with an aerial photo mm-hmm. of the city today and see if you can find any correlation.
Yeah, and I mean, I'm a big private property guy, but would you say government has some role? I mean, look at downtown Fort Wayne, and you could argue maybe that would have happened anyway. Maybe you could argue it shouldn't have happened at all, you know. But at one point, should government jump in?
I'll give that to you.
Well, many times success, in particular in local government, is measured by the ribbon cuttings and by what goes on with respect to activities within downtown area. Particularly downtown is a big thing. But in order to make a evaluation, whether it's successful or non-successful, of course, this is my accounting background, you know, you have to dig under the hood and you have to say, well, where does this money come from? How is it financed? What's the impact that it's had on alternative investments and things of that nature? The truth of the matter is that taxes have gone up, and they've gone up considerably with respect to municipal financing. Mm-hmm. And so we don't know what the alternative would have been, but had those resources been allocated to individual decision making, it may very well be that the advancement of the community would have been much better.
This is a rumor, but I've heard that our old president Mike Pence's administration has a plan to simply award. Maybe a lot of this would be federal money. I don't know, but award each city or certain MSAs $1 billion sums, and just sort of hand it to them and let them go to it.
Well, hopefully we'll all get our share, but I've got to wrap it up. We have about 30 seconds.
Count me in.
Real quick, if anyone wants more information about the foundation, website, what is your website?
www.inpolicy.org.
And while you're remembering all that, be sure to check this and other episodes of the Fort Report at www.news-sentinel.com. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time.
Very good.